今から約100年前のこと、シカゴとデトロイトのほぼ中間にあるミシガン州カラマズーという町で一人の男が店を開いた。彼の趣味はウッドワーキングと音楽。開いた店はマンドリンやギターを製造して売る店だった。男の名はオービル・ギブソン。ギターカンパニーギブソンの誕生だ。オービルは当時人気の高かったマンドリンを中心に数々の独創的な楽器を作り続けた。例えば37本の弦を持つハープチター。ギターもマンドリンも個性的で優雅な独特のラインを持っていた。彼の作る楽器は評判を呼び、マンドリンブームにも乗ってギブソンは次第にその規模を拡大し、アメリカを代表するギターカンパニーになった。楽器の質とそのバラエティにおいてギブソンの右に出る者はいなかった。しかし60年代以降、ライバル関係にあった2つのギターカンパニー、ギブソンとフェンダーは皮肉にも同じ運命をたどった。大会社による買収、大量生産、そして質の低下、信頼は失われた。85年ギブソンは新しいオーナーのもとで再スタートを切った。90年以上の歴史を持つギブソンのアコースティック部門がモンタナ州ボーズマンに移ってきたのはまだ3年前のことだ。アメリカンロッキーの山懐に抱かれた小さな町ボーズマン。ここにあるギブソンアコースティックは古く、そして新しい会社だ。ここの総責任者であるラリー・イングリッシュに今の彼らの位置について尋ねてみた。
Orville was a creative, innovative master luthier, and kind of set the stage for the company and what it would stand for in the future. And he was very innovative and creative and rather eccentric. And that eccentricity somehow has carried on throughout the company, I guess by osmosis over the years. And so even today, Gibson is still a bit eccentric in the way it does things. We had rather a wonderful growth period for perhaps the first almost 80 years. And then the company became purchased by another outside firm, and quality changed and things changed, and we began to lose our foothold in the music industry. And it wasn't until 1985, when Henry Juskowitz and Dave Berryman purchased the company and took it private, that things began to change again. And it was their mission to bring Gibson guitar back to its former glory. And that is the mission that we are all involved in today. Things have really begun to click, and we now are beginning to feel and believe, as the critics are, that Gibson acoustic guitars are probably built better now than they ever have in history before. And this sometimes is a tough bite for people to take, but it really is happening, and we feel really great about it. The eccentricity that that Orville implanted in the company still exists, and it happens in the form where we build a lot of innovative and different instruments, and very often we'll do short runs of them, and this creates a lot of interest in the company and outside the company, and there are many people out there who end up with an instrument which may have only come out of a run of 30 or 40 or less guitars. Regardless of the length of our history, there was a period of time where the king fell out of favor, and we are responding to that now, and bringing the king back to his rightful position. And it reminds me of so many comeback stories where For example, the boxer who had won so many competitions and so many challenges and perhaps took a knockdown. And you know, as the audience watches, he comes back to the ring and makes his comeback. And it's that person who America, who the world really loves. Everybody loves a comeback story, and that really is Gibson right now.
ギブソンアコースティックの工場の内部はうっすらと黄色く曇っていた。木を切り削り磨くときに出る細かな音楽くずのせいだ。漂う音楽くずと強い木材の香り。ギターは木という生き物から作られている。そんな単純で力強い事実がそこにはあった。レン・ファーガソンはこの工場の製作責任者でもあり、アメリカ有数のギター職人でもある。がっしりとした彼の手から作り出されるインレイは繊細でとても美しい。ギブソンがアコースティック部門をモンタナに移す決断を下したのは、このレン・ファーガソンがここに住んでいたからだという。彼はまさにギブソンアコースティックのマスターだ。
My brother was taking lessons from a school teacher that he had, and had a S.S. Stewart banjo and wanted to play bluegrass. And I was in high school shop and wanted to build him a better banjo. And so I attempted to do that. And after showing that to the local music store, they suggested that I do some repair for them.Began to do guitar repair, and after a couple years of doing that, I graduated. I went to work for them, doing repair and sales, and eventually I had replaced necks and tops and backs and sides, and it became obvious that if I replaced them all on the same instrument that I had a new guitar. And so I started to build the components and put guitars together. Then I worked with Wallachy and Sons in WestWood, California, until I opened my own studio in Santa Monica, and primarily did repair for about a year and a half. There was a great deal to do. Eventually moved to a larger building where I could start producing guitars and banjos, and the market was very hot or excited for banjos at the time, so most of the work was re-necking old Gibson banjo pots.And Gibson, who was selling me components to build these banjos, eventually sent a letter to me from their lawyer asking me to cease and desist from using patterns and shapes of their design and origin, or they would bring legal suit against me. And so I formed the Ferguson Guitar and Banjo Company at that time and built onlyFerguson instruments. I think anyone that works here and that has the love and the passion of building musical instruments realizes that their next attempt will be better than their last. I know that as I work, whether I engraving or cutting shell, doing carving, shaping braces, each time I enter into a job, I recognize my ability for the next job will be improved because of the work I've just completed. And that it's not always in the same place, but I look to improve my work. So I notice where I can do better each time. I think a lot of the people here have that, that same interest level. John Sebastian came and visited our factory. This last spring, and he came to order a guitar. We had met him at the NAMM show this last winter. When he had an opportunity to talk to the people in the plant, one of the individuals was real excited to meet this famous personality and said to him, Mr. Sebastian, I have your album at home. And John even more excitedly responded and said, I have your guitar at home. And I get to play it in my living room every night. And that was a special pat on the back to us, to have an entertainer as appreciative of the work that we're doing here.
Gibson Acoustic の1日の生産量は40本から45本。その全てが50以上にも及ぶチェックリストをくぐり抜けてきたギターだ。職人たちは黙々とギターを作り、そして休憩時間になるとバレーボールを楽しんでいた。他の工場の例に漏れず、ギブソンアコースティックにも多くのギタリストたちがいる。中でも興味深かったのは、セールスプロモーションを担当しているロビ・ジョーンズだ。彼はフライトというグループを組んで、モントルージャズフェスティバルにも参加した。しかしその後、レコードデビューにつきまとうビジネスの煩雑さを嫌い、グループを解散してモンタナに戻ってきたのだという。だが、ビジネスを嫌ったはずのロビは現在、この会社でギタービジネスに関わる仕事をしている。今でも自宅でソロアルバムを作っているというロビに話を聞いた。
Played guitar since I was playing with my toys at home as a little child, and I always dreamed of being a performer. And as the years went on, I went to school and studied different types of guitar performing, which included classical, jazz, and rock. So all my life, that's what I concentrated on. Curiously enough, the romantic part of my own personal story, at least in my own remembrance, is that my first guitar was a Kalamazoo guitar. I was a little child going into a music store. My mother turned to me, and I looked up at the electric guitars at the time in awe. I'd never seen such beautiful guitars, and she pulled down. She had already chosen one with the salesperson, and it was a Kalamazoo guitar, which was one of the early low-priced Gibson electric guitars. And I said, "Mother, that's." Much better, that's too much. And she said, well, if you're gonna play guitar, play the best. I'll spend the money. And back then, which was longer than I'd like to admit, it was hundreds of dollars, a couple hundred dollars. And the amplifier was an Epiphone amp. So I didn't realize that the rest of my life I would be playing guitars from the same company. Well, when I perform, I definitely leave business go. I think what happens to a lot of artists is that they use a certain frame of creativity, the dreamer part, if you will. And if they are, when they rise up the ladder, they are forced more and more to deal with questions that they don't normally deal with. And because of their lack of experience in that, it becomes very confusing. And that confusion takes away from the creativity because it's a lot of pressure. Begins a lot of pressure. They were asking me questions. I had to make a lot of decisions. With Gibson, the balance, or with Gibson, I've learned how to answer the questions and how to market, how to talk with corporate heads and artist producers. And with that experience now, it's much more a part of me. And I'm not sure if I'm answering the question clearly, but now I feel that it is about a new part of me that is calmly a part of the artist. Now I can come and play, and at the same moment, after the performance, I can talk business. And it's very natural now. So I think that's a lot of artists have trouble with business. They say, oh, just hire somebody, take care of that. I don't want to think about that. Or when you ask them a question, their face goes blank. They don't know the answer. Well, I think, you know, working with Gibson has given me a lot of the answers. And in business, this is a much better part of the, more fun part of business for me, working with these instruments being built here, because there's a dream that I can connect to, that we all feel here, that we're continuing the Gibson tradition. And that's the artist part of me. And then the business part says, we gotta tell everybody in the world, and that's marketing, a part of marketing. So it kind of works together with my artist part. ¶¶
I called a friend of mine who had a music store in Philadelphia, and he had this 1922 Gibson Model A for, again, a very reasonable price, all things considered. So I went and grabbed it, and I put a pickup on it, a Barkus Berry, a transducer, as opposed to the electromagnetic variety, so I'd get the real vibrations of the body, and took it out live, and it sounded great. It's a very funky instrument. I wish I had it here. It's similar to this. It's got the same shape, the A shape, but instead of having the F holes, it's got a round sound hole. It's a little deeper sounding, a little woodier sounding than this. Again, it records okay. It's not, it doesn't have the bright ping that you get from the F holes. It's a little more woofy on the middle. I think I used that on One Way Home, Washington's Day, I think was that. And then when I was on the road, I acquired several instruments, one of which was a 1908 Gibson A4, which again has the round sound hole. This one is all black and has a, if you look inside, it's got a picture of Orville Gibson. Well, Lloyd Lohr was this guy in 1910, 20, somewhere back in the way back when, who walked into Gibson and said, I can build a better mandolin than you can. So they gave him the parts. And he said, if I can build a better mandolin, you give me a job. And he went in and he built one better than they had. So he stuck around for a few years and built all these mandolins, and then he disappeared. Never heard from again. So we didn't really know how much we were going to use it when we recorded Nervous Night. But as we got into the studio, it just kept popping up, you know, in different tracks. I think, and we danced, we knew we had that intro. And I think that was about it going into it. The Day by Day was originally a guitar line, and then this just kind of popped up. And you have to be careful because there's certain parts on a mandolin that are hard to hear over a rock and roll rhythm track. So, but when you get the right part, you know it, because all of a sudden it just pops out. It just sits in the track, and it just peeks its little head above everybody else and says, hi, I'm a mandolin and I'm rocking. For me, it's the fact that I don't really know what I'm doing on it, but I can put my fingers down anywhere and get a great sound. One finger. It's just tuned that way, even open, the open strings. Rob calls it the riff machine, because a great many of the chordal riffs that we come up with, even the ones that wind up being played on a keyboard or in a guitar, originate on this instrument. You know, like... and so on and so forth. It's just, and it's, you know, it's got that woody sound. Mountainous, you know. I'm playing a lot on other people's records now too, especially when I'm here, when I'm in LA, because I have a lot of friends here, and there aren't a lot of people who play this instrument, and I kind of hope it stays that way for a while anyway. But people are shocked, you know, when I bring it into the studio and they hear what it can do. I think it's got this reputation of being a gondola. Gondolieri! Waiter! Sort of a thing. I just played on Johnny Clegg's album, and it goes great with Zulu guitar. It was amazing how organically it just fit in with the rhythms that he does and the music that he writes. I can take this anywhere. I do. You know, I take it on airplanes, I play it. I played it on our last flight to Japan, actually, upstairs on that 747. And it can rock. That's the thing about it. You can really lean into it. I mean, I can just sit there and meditate on an A chord. Forever and ever, it just feels good beneath the arm. The girls like it, it's a good one for serenading. Mi bella.
ギブソンアコースティックでは昔ながらのやり方でギターが作られていた。例えばネックの形を整える作業はフレットを入れバインディングを施した後で行われる。どうしてわざわざ作業を難しくするのかと尋ねると、それがオービルのやり方だったからさという答えが返ってきた。住所は1894オービルウェイ。彼らは98年前にマンドリンから始まったギブソンの新たな歴史を今ここで作ろうとしている。モンタナ州の別名はビッグスカイステート。その名の通り、ここでは空がとてつもなく広い。その広い空にさまざまな表情を持った雲が浮かんでいる。大地に恵みを与える雨雲、その上に幾層もの綿雲が重なり、頭の上には筋雲と青空。どこまでも続く麦畑はなだらかな丘につながり、そして丘は山となってロッキー山脈へと続く。僕らはボーズマンからイエローストーン国立公園まで車を走らせた。モンタナとワイオミングの州境にあるイエローストーンまでは100マイル余り。道は延々と山あいを縫って走っていく。いくつもの山と小さな町をやり過ごしながら数時間走ると、突然視界が開けた。悠然と広がる高原だ。しかしその高原のはるか向こう、地平線のあたりにはまた無数の山々が頂を覗かせていた。アメリカを開拓したパイオニアたちは地図も持たず、自分の足でこんな土地に分け入り、そしてあちこちに町を作っていった。アメリカの開拓史をそのまま肯定することはできないが、パイオニアたちが人間の力だけで雄大な自然と立ち向かい、そして自然とつながっていった事実だけは認めなければならない。モンタナを包む森や丘、山々、そしてどこまでも広い空、ギブソンのアコースティックギターはそんな環境で作られている。
after midnight, gonna let it all hang out. After midnight.
An instrument like this is supported by your chin and your shoulder. It's the weight.
We're jumping into the breach with an instrument that is professional quality, but it's less expensive than these museum pieces.
Gates of the schoolyard are padlocked and chained to keep all the children.
We've been able over 159 years to build our reputation to the point where it would be impossible for anyone else to replace us.